Report on the cloud. Okay. Have your camera off. You can turn it off. That's fine because I'm recording this. I'm going to send it to a few people. Will keep it on what you want, but nice. Okay. Will, I'm going to ask if you can't see the board, say something. Too late.
I can see it now. That should be fine, honestly.
I have a screen of what you're seeing. So I'll probably be able to check it a lot. If I'm like writing, you can't see it. It's kind of, is it blurry on your screen too?
No, it looks pretty good on my end, honestly. I can see your hand barely.
All right. Yeah. Yeah, everybody, welcome. I got the practice midterm here. It's on Learning Suite. So we're just going to go through the whole thing. And we will stop and like explain like key concepts of a question talks about elasticity. We can go over that a little bit. I'm going to write key things you should know on this board. And Will, I'll move the camera when I do that. And I'll write maybe like equations that they give us on that board. All right. Also, I am recording this. Sadly, I don't want to, but out of respect for people who are working on recording this, and if you want the recording, I'll send it out. Okay, I'll send it out if you want or not, but you can look at it. All right. So, best way to do this is if you have the exam with you, so I don't have to repeat questions or whatever. On-demand states that holding all else constant. We'll know if price goes down, quantity demand rises. If price goes up, quantity demand decreases. So I can really focus on that. All right. And number two, in a competitive market, the market demand is, the market demand is quantity demanded equals 60 takeaway 6P. And the market supply is quantity supply equals 4P. Price ceiling of $3, price is $3, will result in what's going to happen. To do this, we just look at how much is supplied, how much is demanded, the difference, right? So at $3, point supply equals 4 times 3, 12. And
hey, Peter, can we shift the camera slightly to the left? The only thing I can see is the P equals 3. A little more. Yeah, that's good there.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Thanks.
And then quantity demanded equals, I guess I can look at this, 60 takeaway 6, 3. Quantity demanded, 60 takeaway 18, which is 42. Difference here. I guess you can do quantity demanded, takeaway quantity supplied equals 12. Okay. Now the question is this 30 extra units or a shortage of 30 units? A surplus or shortage? Well, we know that the demand is a lot higher than the supply. There's more people don't want something, they can't all get it. So it is a shortage, 30 units. Okay. If A and B are complements, an increase in the price of good A would, let's find let's define complements and substitutes. First little topic. Maybe let's give examples. What's an example of a complement? Yeah. Example of substitutes. Here's the price of good A.
would do what to its complement? It would decrease the demand of its complement. So that is, let's see.
Yeah.
Which of the following can explain an increase in the demand for housing in retirement communities?
So for this one, let's look at what are factors that shift demand. That'll help us know which of the answers is correct. So demand shifters.
What are things that shift demand? When I say shift, I mean moves the demand curve either this way or this way.
Yeah. With the economy?
Yeah, economy is good.
Changes in the underlying population.
Also, pop changes. Substitutes. Yeah. And let's see, make sure we didn't miss anything. Advertising, change it, and consumer expectations. Expect it'll be gone forever, then they're about like gasoline, you know, it could change the demand people have. All right, so.
And Peter, is one of the ideas with that too, that just that price won't shift the demand curve?
Exactly, yeah, price will not shift the curve. Price will just move you along the demand, but it won't shift it. It's a big thing to know.
So, which explains an increase in the demand for housing retirement communities? A drop in real estate prices, that's a price shift. So that doesn't shift the demand, that just moves that along the curve. An increase in the population of elderly, that would shift the demand. So that's the answer. We'll go to the other ones though. An increase in the average age at which people retire, that would decrease the demand because there's less in the population that it is pertaining to. And a decrease in the cost of living adjustment for retirees, that would, it's living adjustments, they're getting less money, so the income is smaller, which is why the demand is going to be shifted out. If it was an increase in the cost of living adjustment, so they're getting more money from the government, the demand would shift outward. Which of the following market structures would you expect to yield the greatest in-market product variety? We got monopoly, monopolistic competition, monopoly, and perfect competition. The answer is monopolistic competition. Somebody explain why that is, why it's not like monopoly or yeah.
It's because the two firms, they don't want to be competing for the same thing. Like they don't want their products to be identical, because then they move into like a Bertrand oligopoly where they just start competing on price. So they want to differentiate their products so that there's still competition, or so that there's not as much competition.
Exactly. They want to differentiate from each other. So you have lots of variety. If it was like perfect competition, you'd have all the same product. If it was a monopoly, you'd only have one product, which is why it's monopolistic competition.
So Peter, for that question, like if instead of the in-market product variety, let's say instead of product variety, it said like number of firms or something like that, what would which of the following structures would yield, I don't know, greatest in-market?
Firms?
Firms or level of competition. Yeah.
You do perfect competition. It'll be perfect competition if that's a hypothetical, but you don't really know. Like, it doesn't give you enough information to know the most number of firms, you know? But yeah, perfect competition would have the most firms. Usually. All right. Well, everybody, great work on the first page. Going on. I hope this gets a little harder. Six. Number six. Suppose the demand for good X is given quantity demanded of X equals 10 minus 2px plus py plus m. Price of good X is $1. It was one. Y is $10.
and income is $100. Income is always M. Given these prices of income, how much a good X will be purchased? Okay. Well, yeah, we're just going to plug in everything in here. Plus 10. X being purchased is $118. All right. Yeah, this is more interesting now. For a steel factory decreasing the cost of electricity to the point it will cause a supply curve too. So let's go back over to our answer, none of the above. Sorry, D. No. All right. What are supply shifters? So we just did it for demand, but what shifts supply? Lower costs, yeah, input costs. What else does?
Lack of natural resources.
Yes. We'll just say loss of inputs, I guess. If it's like a natural resource is like being depleted, isn't it there? Let's go number of firms. If you have 10 firms producing 100 things each, and then you have 20 firms producing 100 things each, you're always going to have more supply. It's going to shift the whole demand supply curve. Taxes, government regulations. Yeah. Okay. So if electricity decreases our supply curve here, then what happens? Decrease of cost of electricity to the plant. So your costs are going down, your input costs or just your costs as a plant are going down. You're going to shift to the right here. All right. Because you're going to produce more for the same price for the market. So the answer is C, shift to the right. All right. Suppose market demand supply are given by quantity demand equals 100 take away 2P and quantity supply equals 5 plus 3P. The equilibrium price is, we're going to set those equal to each other. So, yeah, set them equal, price 19. All right. Yeah, okay, you guys got that one. All right. Oh, this is good. All right. Back to my board. Okay, A/B testing would make sense. So let's go through all the different analysis types that we went through in class. Make sure you guys don't miss those on the quiz.
All
right. So we had testing, analysis. And max diff, do you guys do that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you have any other ones? B testing, what's that? So you have two different options you want to see, is A or B better. Conjoint analysis, anybody grab that one?
About two stuff, right?
Yes. Yeah, you have lots of different options and you want to see like which of the options that people like the most. So
feature combination.
Yeah, it's a feature combination. Thank you. Not options, more features. Lots of different features, which features are the most important. And then max diff. Does anybody know what a max diff is? Yeah.
If you ask like for like the best one and the worst one, and then by that you can figure out what like other features like people prefer. Because like if you say A is like the best one, then you know A is better than all the rest of the options. This one's the worst one, you know that one's. It just shows like how it's greater than all the other ones by just answering two things.
Exactly. Yeah, try to find the absolute best ones, the ones that are the greater than everything else, the ones that are the worst, since you can kind of compare them there. All right. So A/B testing makes sense in which of two versions of the landing page leads to more versions on a website. Which one will we use to see how consumers rank product features of a new product? Yep. The average variable cost of a proposed new product, that's just economics. And what product features consumers value the most highly?
Active.
All right. Okay. Number 10, suppose market demand supply are given by quantity demanded.
You write this on.
Yeah, number 10.
Demand equals 100 minus 2P, and quantity supplied equals 5 plus 3P, and the price for $30. And the government agrees to purchase all surplus at $30 per unit. What's the total cost of the government? So first we need to find out how much surplus there is. So we can see at $30, the quantity demanded, plug it in, is 40. And at $30, the quantity supplied is 95. The surplus yes, but is 55 the amount of the government's, the cost of the government? No, because they're spending $30 per unit. They're going to buy back each unit at $30. So 55 total cost equals 55 times the price, which will give us 150. 1650. All right, which is that? That makes sense? Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, OPE, own price elasticity demand here. This is good for everybody. Okay. So moving on. Okay. Own price elasticity of demand is -2 for a certain firm's product. If the firm raises price, the firm's manager can expect total revenue to decrease, increase, or remain constant. Decrease, exactly. So let's go, let's write out some OPE guidelines here. If elasticity is less than 1, then the absolute value. Is it elastic or inelastic? One is unitary. It's more than 1, it's elastic. I think in is like inferior, like bad, and it's less than 1, so it's like worse than 1. So.
All right, Peter, question for you. Could unitary elastic be 1 or -1 considering its absolute value?
Yes, that is correct. It could be 1 or -1. Okay. Now let's break down what this means. If the own price elasticity demand is -2, that means that a 1% increase in price leads to a -2% change in quantity. So that's what elasticity is telling us. So let me put it up here. If OPE is -2% of -2, price. Oh, I didn't write that like more simple, but I guess you just look at the.
Yeah. If you, it's not -2, so if it's still 2, is that still also any last, like when
it's
still
down? So if you're looking at absolute value,
I'll never be possible. It would not be an upward sloping demand curve.
Yeah, I'll never be possible.
Like
it's always.
So would it be like, could you technically just multiply that by like a 1% change, 1 times whatever that is, and assume that's like a 2%? Or is that not always going to?
That sounds right to me. I like that. Okay. So I think we'll get to that later on.
Okay.
So I know what it talks about. I'll make sure it is right. All right. Yeah. How do we calculate own price elasticity? He gives you guys a super complicated equation in the slides. I'm just gonna write it out in terms that make sense. So I want to find the own price elasticity of good X. I'm gonna look at derivative. Times that by the price of X over the quantity of X. All right, so don't get confused. I think, do you guys have this on your formula sheet? Yeah, so he has like, yeah, so the man for good X been estimated by
switch back over for 40.
Man for good X been estimated by quantity. This is problem 12. Vanity of X equals 12 minus 3 P X plus 4 Y. Good X is $2. Good Y is $1. Calculate the own price elasticity. All right, so we want to find the own price elasticity of X using our little equation on the board. Look for the derivative, which is negative 3, times that by the price, which is 2, over the quantity of X. We don't know what the quantity of X is yet. We have all the numbers, so we can solve for it. So we're going to solve for that right here. 20X equals 12 minus 3 times 2 plus 4. Quantity of X, 12 minus 6 plus 4 is 10. All right. Its own price elasticity, negative 3. 2 minus 10, 2 over 10, sorry. So we get 6 tenths. All right, makes sense, OP, yeah, sweet. 13, own price elasticity of demand for apples is negative 1.2. Price of apples falls by 5%, so price is gonna go down by 5%. What happens to the quantity of apples demanded? So to find that, we're just going to do the own price elasticity by the change in price, so 0.05. And we are going to get 0.06, which means it's going to increase by 6%. 5%, 6%. So that one makes sense too. And that's kind of good. Okay. Ooh. Conjoint analysis would probably involve, this is a true or false question. Asking consumers to rank their preferences among sets of product features. Is that or is that not conjoint analysis? That is. The answer is B. It's actually multiple choice. You know what? I'll give you another one. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, that one. Would it be negative 1.6? Wait, wouldn't it be?
So it's a D.
I'm sorry, this should be a negative because it goes down by 5%. I just want to negative something there. Thank you. Yeah. If this was negative, it would decrease by 6%. Okay. Yeah, now let's go to cross price elasticity. The cross price elasticity between good A and B is negative. We know that the goods are complements. Let's write that on the board. Cross price elasticity. So B is more than zero. Substitute B is less than zero. Formula there. Yeah, let's do some calculus. Good. Whiteboard. So, this one's good. This one's definitely on the test a couple times, pretty sure. So, Total cost function for a firm is 100 plus 12Q plus 20Q squared plus 15Q. What's the marginal cost of producing five units using the point-to-point method and using the calculus method? Okay, so we want to do point-to-point. That marginal cost for producing five units. So we are going to do three units and five units and calculate the difference. And the reason why we do four instead of six to five is we want the cost of producing one additional unit. The fifth unit is like the additional unit. So we're going from four to five, not from five to six. All right. So four units. Do this, we're just gonna plug four in. All that math, you get 1028. Yeah. Now let's do five units. Yeah. See, this is the total cost of producing five units. This is the total cost of producing four units. To find the marginal cost, the difference in cost, we $1,107. Right away, we know the answer is B. Someone that has that. We're going to keep going and do calculus right now. All right. So for the calculus method, we need to find the marginal cost. We don't have the cost function, so we gotta do some derivative action. Cost function will be 12 plus 40Q plus 45 squared. Nice. And then we want the marginal cost of producing the fifth unit. What number do we plug in for Q? It's the only number you really have. That'd be worse. Marginal cost equals 1,337. Nice. So you want to make sure you're not do that and solve for both of those. Okay, you produce good X. If your good is estimated to be this, price is this. What's the cross price elasticity? So let's put our crush price elasticity formula on board so we have it. So that is going to be derivative.
Peter, can you scan over to that sideboard again?
Derivative of Y. Just remember, for these is always price on top, quantity on bottom, just how it is. And quantity cross price elasticity up. Fit in relation, a good X and good Y. How good X changes based on the change of the price of Y. And you know that because the equation they give you is just trying to find the quantity of X. You're trying to find a quantity of Y, and you can't even find the quantity of Y. So you're looking at the effect that the price of Y has on the quantity of X. So we're going to solve this problem. I'm just going to assume everybody has the problem in front of them on the exam. I'm not going to write it all out. It's pretty long. Write it all out. You guys have the exam in front of you. Okay. All right, sweet. 17 across price elasticity. I want to take my derivative of y. Now look here, I can see that the equation says plus 2y, 2py, so my derivative is 2. And then the price of y, which they tell me is 12. Then I want to put that over the quantity of x, which I don't have yet. So let me solve for that. Quantity x equals 100, take away 3. Price of x, which they give me is 10, plus 2. Price of y, which is 12. 5. Price of z, which is 8. Take from a quantity of x, 82. Plug that in up here. I'm going to get 0.2927 CPD, which is A. It's not negative because there's no negatives here. It's positive. Then. 18. You increase ketchup and you calculate the cross-price elasticity between your ketchup and hamburgers. It's negative 1.2. A 4% increase in the price of hamburgers will lead to. So for this one, you just want to look at, they give us the cross-price elasticity, which is negative 1.2. They give us the percent increase, which is 4%. So that will give us negative 0.048, which is 4.8%. Which means that if hamburgers increase by 4% in price, then there's going to be a 4.8% drop in demand for ketchup, which is a compliment. So, and that's a compliment because it's negative. But this is less than zero. It's negative. All right, how are we doing? Honestly, I'm pretty thirsty myself. Drink some water. Do whatever you want. Bye. Yeah, settle down, everybody. All right. 17. Heck yeah. All right. The most effective, I don't know if this is like helpful or not. Like, I don't know. I feel like I'm just going through it. Okay. This is right. Yeah, it's good to know. I feel like, I'm like, okay.
You know what? That makes me happy. It was so
helpful. I'm like, I don't know if this is even doing anything. I don't know how else to do a review, though. No.
I just didn't watch a lot of it.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You got the trap music, though. We'll put that back on at 12:15 while I go fill my water. Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, guys. Little announcement. I am going to the Zoo tomorrow. My buddies bought our tickets. We're all going, and we might. Has anybody worked at a zoo before? A little bit. That's a little confusing.
I'm in service at a zoo for like 5 or 6 months.
So, what's the deal with like feeding monkeys? Is it actually bad?
Or then he like sprinkles things. I don't know. I don't remember.
Eating what kind of service were you doing at the? Where was your mission?
In Virginia.
Okay. It's pretty sick. Yeah. Service at the zoo.
Yeah, pretty fun. Mainly just doing like gardening crap.
But so you were like working with the animals.
Not really. No.
That'd be a lot of trust to give.
Yeah. Sure, but.
Yeah, me and the boys were debating if we're going to bring bananas or not.
Peter, I think the worst thing that would happen is you'd have a really good story for 2 truths and a lie.
That's true. I already have those on lock, first of all, and second of all.
Do it at the end of the day.
Well, yeah, the worst thing that could happen is a chimpanzee could die. I want to make sure that eat bananas. So I'm like,
I just saw someone with one of my friends on his Instagram story. He just gave a monkey a banana, and he was really excited, and it was fine. So
at the zoo?
I think he's like in some foreign country.
I was gonna say third world countries. I feel like it's fine.
He might get kicked out, but like it probably won't kill him, you know.
All right, we'll have to see. I'll consult with the boys. All right. So 18. On to the next. On to 19. I'm going to need some more water in a second, though. So 12:15, maybe 12:20, we'll be a little water break.
So another equation for cross price elasticity is the sheet. This one's simply given, for example, like percent change of quantity of X over the percent change of quantity of price of Y. And you calculate that. This is not on your sheet, I don't think. This is quantity 2 minus Q1 over Q1. The percent change. I always get kind of confused on which quantity am I subtracting, or, you know, I get a little confused on that. So this is kind of simplified. It's Q2 minus Q1 over Q1. All that. Q2 minus P1 over. This screen doesn't show the whiteboard. You guys all yell or something, and then I can make sure I flip it over. All right. You know, I mean, I'm not gonna change it between now and like, well, once I move, you can tell me. Okay. All right. 19. Like, suppose you sell applesauce and pork chops. Sales data shows that a pork chop, at a pork chop price of $8, you sell 100 jars of applesauce. So, if price is $8. These are the. Quantity applesauce. I'm gonna say price of pork chops, PPC maybe, pork chops, and then quantity of applesauce, QAP, equals 100. All right. At PPC of $6, QAP equals 140. So it says, what's the cross price elasticity at $6? And it's two parts, also the CPE at $8. All right, at $6, put a dollar sign here. So at $6, we wanna take our quantity two. So our original quantity is at $6, 140. So quantity two is 100 minus quantity one, which is 140. Divide that by 140. Quantity one is always the quantity you have when you're start, like at your price here starting at, which is six. That's why it's 100. Okay. Then we're going to divide that all by price of two. So price two is eight. Price of one, which is six over price of one, which is six. And we get for that the math. A simplifying step, but you can just use a calculator. Just use your iPhone horizontal. $8. So we want our quantity one at $8 is going to be the quantity we're at, which is 40. Quantity two is 100. Quantity one's 140. Of this, and we're gonna do over 6 minus 8 over 8. Oh, I mean, sorry, messing up on my notes here. But this equals negative 1.6. All right. So at $6, our cross price elasticity is negative 0.85, and $8. So now what does this mean? The fact that this one's above one, this one's below one. Uh-oh, it doesn't matter. All that matters is if it's negative or positive. And it's negative, which means.
Hey, why did you do 140 minus 100 divided by 140?
Because. Why is it 100?
Because it's divided by. It's just supposed to be that way. I just know.
Yeah.
It's not right.
Quantity one. 40 And the starting quantity is Q1, which is 100.
Right.
It's the structure.
Yeah. So, okay, good. That mistake was not on purpose, but yeah, we got that. All right. I like this problem, number 20. That's one of my favorite ones, actually. So, buckle up. All right. Of labor will have what effect on the isocost line on a KL graph? All right, so it tells us L is on horizontal, K is on vertical for isocost. So this one, you don't need a graph really. You think, okay, if labor increases, I'm going to use less labor, right? So I'm going to move to the left. Which, if you look at all of your options, it's going to decrease the horizontal intercept. But before, if you're using 10 amount of like 10 units of labor, and the price of labor goes up, you're probably going to use 8 units of labor or whatever. That decreases the intercept of how many units of labor you're using. I don't know, so you just kind of think through that. All right. On isocost. I think everything you said in class was good. You know, that one's a little tricky because we don't talk about isocost or isoquants that much. But. All right, the cost function of a firm has been determined to be 250 plus 3q plus 1.5q squared plus 0.75q cubed. What's the average fixed cost of producing 5 units? All right, well, we know the fixed cost because it doesn't change no matter how many units you produce. If we look at our equation, the fixed cost is just 250. Because all the other ones have Q on them, so we change units, then that would change. So average fixed cost is 250 divided by 5. There's an average fixed cost of 50. The answer is C. Right. We went over in class, let's go over it briefly. The marginal product of labor is 8, and the marginal product of capital is 2. And the wage rate is 4, price capital is 2. So since this is bigger, 8 divided by 4 is 2, it's bigger than 1. We want to use more of our labor. Should label that. You guys understand? Well, I'm not explaining really like kind of why we do this. So if we just remember, like sometimes people forget like what marginal product actually means. That's just the last thing produced, or the last output produced by something. And so you're looking at the price to produce that output with the wage rate or the rental rate of capital. So when you do this, I don't know if that made any sense, but we'll get to that later on too when we go through it a little deeper together. All right. So, you trick some people up. So, here you go, 23. I'm still good on the whiteboard?
Yeah.
Nice. All right, 23. Suppose the production function is given by Q equals 3K plus 4L. What is the average product of capital when 10 units of capital and 10 units of labor are employed? All right. We say Q equals 10 units of capital and 10 units of labor. Q equals 70. So what's the average product of capital? It's a little tricky because you might think, oh, I just want to find out how much capital specifically is producing. But the thing is, it's all connected. So you want to look at the total production and divide that by the amount of capital, and you get 7. So average product capital equals 7. All right, it's not 3. You understand that? Yes, sweet. It is confusing. You guys get why that's confusing though? Because you might think, oh, I just find just what's capital is only producing, but since everything's so connected, if you use more capital, say you use 4 or 5 capital, your production thing, everything would change. Your average would also change.
I have no idea how you okay. Let's go like I understand that or I don't understand that. Like just be honest. All right. Yeah. Okay. I'm glad I have that little question there. So let me think of a way to explain that makes sense.
They both weren't 10. So if it's like 10 and then 12, you would just divide the number by the total, right? To find the average of like what capital and labor was affecting. So if like labor was 12 or whatever, it wouldn't be 10 for both. So you would just divide it by whatever was being used by that number, right? So if it's 12, you solve it and then solve for 12.
So I think we're on the right path here. So okay, yeah, let's say something like a both 10 and make 10. Yeah. Let's make it 5. So our quantity produced here is 30 plus 20. So our quantity is 50. Okay. And then our average production or of capital is going to be 50 divided by the amount of units of capital we use, which is 10. So it's 5 here. I'm trying to think.
It's like total production divided by units of
but it's the units of the input that you're looking to see the average of. So if you're looking for average units of or average product of labor, you would take the total production and divide it by however many units of labor you use.
Basically, it's just like taking the total quantity that they produced with the combination of labor and capital and just dividing by whatever they ask for. Like if they ask for the average like labor in that situation, we're going to divide it by 5.
Exactly. And the reason why you don't just divide the specific thing by is because since it's all connected, like you can't just only produce, like you can't just only have like labor and no capital or something and then have like divide by 0. You know, like you just can't do that. So, okay, I'm not explaining it super clear. Literally last night at 1 a.m., I went through the test. I thought this is how I'm going to explain this to make it so clear. I didn't write it down. So when we're done, average. Yes, Will.
Can we just do number 23 just with completely new numbers and just ask it like instead of capital, switch it to labor and do maybe 5K and 7L. Let's say the cost of capital. Yeah, 7K, 5L, product capital.
I never thought your numbers, but
sure.
Just yeah.
Here's our quantity. What is it called? Production function. Here's our production function. Okay, so let's solve. So here are our inputs. We're using 10 units of capital and 20 units of labor. How much do we produce when we use this much? All right, we just want to see how much is our total production. So we say 20 times 10. Plus 100 times 20. The total production is 200 plus 2000. So it's our total production. So what's the average? What's our average product of labor? Divided by 20. And so our quantity, what our quantity is giving us is how much we're producing, our total production using this much labor and this much capital. But if capital was set 200, let's just say it's set, like there's, it doesn't matter how many units of capital, like we, it's just always going to be 200. A fixed capital unit. We still, we use both these numbers and divide it by the units of labor that we use. So, yeah, I don't know if that helps at all. I'm sorry. But Will, he's there.
Oh, I'm here, Peter. Omnipresent. That helps. Thank you.
I mean, it's just such a. Yeah, because you're looking at the average produced in regards to labor or in regards to capital. You have a total amount produced. Like you can't just like. In this formula, you can divvy it up. The formula is like linear, but usually you can't just like separate them. Like it's all connected. And you want to know, okay, if I use 10 units of labor to produce this, what's my average?
If I use 5 units of labor to produce this, what's my average per unit of labor? That will change as you're changing your labor, no matter what capital it is. If you're looking for an average of. So, yeah, we'll just, yeah, that's just how it is. Sorry, that wasn't more clear. Or that isn't more clear. I wish it was. All right. Okay. Oh, this is good. All right. 24. For the production function, Q equals 5.2K plus 3.8. A equals 16 and L equals 12, which we don't care about. We know that the marginal product of K is 5.2. All right. Now that's because if we add 1 unit of K, our production produced is going to go up by 5.2. So we had no units of K, we produce 0 from K. If we had 1 unit of K, we produce 5.2 from K. We have 2 units of K. Like every, our marginal product of capital is just what the token units. Okay. Let's do a thumbs on that one too. You guys understand that one? Okay, so it's just okay. The inverse demand. Oh, nice. All right. Inverse demand for good X is given by PX equals 65.5 QX. So this is inverse demand because it's not a quantity demanded curve like with Q equals whatever. So it's just inverted. How much consumer surplus do consumers receive when the price of good X is 40? All right. So draw our graph here. This is price. We know that at one point price is 40. So we want to find out what the quantity is at 40. And we also want to know how much would consumers be willing to pay. For just like how much would the top consumer be willing to pay? So the guy who's going to pay the most money, so we can find out what our the idea of that, we're going to find the intercept when quantity demanded is 0. Zero equals 60. Of X equals 65. Take away 0.5, quantity of 0. So price of X equals 65. All right. So we know that when quantity is 0, the price will be 65. Okay. And then we want to find when price is 40, what's the quantity demanded? So 40 equals 65 0.5 Q. Q equals 50. We're looking for this, sorry to make her, we're looking for this triangle right here. So we're gonna do 55 take away 40 would be the height of that triangle. 50 would be the width of that triangle. And then 0.5, so we can find the area of the triangle. So we get 5, times 50, times 0.5, and that comes out to 625. This is a pretty good concept to know. It's always really important to know, but this one sometimes people get tripped up on like which area am I calculating. And so you want to look, this is consumer surplus. Consumer. The reason why it's up here is because consumer surplus is just the sum of the extra benefit somebody's getting at that quantity of good. So if a good, if somebody pays $40 for a good and they're willing to pay $65 for a good, this is all the extra benefit they're getting. If the next person down the line would pay $63 for the good, but they only have to pay $40. This is all the extra benefit they're getting. And then we just add all these up together. That's where we find the area of the triangle. That gives us consumer surplus. So if you ever get confused, like, which triangle am I looking at? Just kind of think, okay, what, like, what's going on? How much will this person pay for the good? How much are they actually paying? That's consumer surplus. Acquire surplus, producer surplus, is the exact same, the opposite. So this for supplier, he would produce the good for $10 if he was selling for $10, but somebody's buying for $40. He's getting $30 extra of surplus, which is this line right here, and so on, so on, so on. Add that all together, that gets you your producer surplus. So let's go to 26. At 30, I'm gonna play that trap song. So, okay, cost function is variable cost of producing 10 units. So cost equals what? And quantity equals 10. All right, so for this one, we want to take out our fixed cost, which is 250. So we're going to say our variable cost function is just 2. Well, it's 2 cubed. So with all the cubes, I'm going to replace cubes, though, with the quantity we have. Variable cost, we have 182. Oh, 1820. I'm going to divide that by 10 and find our average variable cost equals 182. All right. Any questions on finding average variable cost? If I would have asked us to find our average fixed cost with 10 units, we just do 250 divided by 10. All right. Okay, door to diner. All right. Door to diner has a menu with a cost function of cost. She has several competitors and she's a price taker, which tells us that we want, I'll keep going. How many meatloaf plates does she sell each day to maximize profits? And she's a price taker. And so what's her profit maximizing price as a price taker, as a price maker? What do we want to say equal to each other? The cost, okay. And then the cost of everything is pasta is $8. Meatloaf is $12, veggie is $6. All right. So our marginal cost, on the marginal cost of which good are we, meatloaves, we need to find the derivative of M. So we can cancel everything else out. Cancel, cancel, cancel. And to find the derivative of M, we would do some marginal cost M. Our little trick, so we get 1.2. All right. Now, if we want to set marginal cost for the marginal revenue, we know marginal revenue is just the price that we're selling it for. So we do 1.2 M equals 12. We get M equals 10. Now, if I ask you to find how many veggie plates should she sell, we do the same thing, but we just look for the derivative for veggies. It's how that equal the price of the vegetables.
This maker, what would we set equal for a price maker? What's the difference?
That would be a monopoly. So what is monopoly's
profit maximizing.
Well, margin revenue, don't you do like the 2ABQ, or like you basically, I don't know what it was, but you basically take one of them.
The next one's an example of what you're maximizing revenue.
Yes. What about monopolies?
Margin
revenue,
right?
That's what I thought too.
Well, it's for margin revenue, though.
Yeah, but
all right.
It was P, whereas it's not in a monopoly.
So that's right. Okay, that makes sense. So to find the marginal revenue, we use the marginal revenue function, and we'll go over that. I think it's coming up, but that's. Second. All right. So 28 does use marginal revenue for revenue maximizing output. All right. So if you want revenue maximizing output for a good, then this isn't related to Doris Diner. All right. But same thing. Okay. So what's the total revenue maximizing output for good X? If the demand function is 2X equals 96 minus 4VX. All right. So to maximize total revenue, we want to set marginal revenue equal to zero. You remember why conceptually we do that? We do that because, let's see, the best way to say it. We want to be producing, like, we want to get as much production as we can until we start losing money. That makes sense. So we want to just keep putting goods out until the cost of the marginal revenue, so the profit of the very last good is like zero. I mean, the revenue of the very last good is zero. I didn't explain anything really at all. So I'm sorry if that didn't help.
It's the peak of the
market. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, it is.
The more you output, you're going to be less efficient.
Yeah, because eventually, if you start producing too much, you're going to lose money at production. So you want to go just right to the point, just right before you lose money, because if not, then you could produce one more and still make more money. That's how I should explain it. So if you're producing for 10, okay, you guys get that? All right. Okay, sweet. All right. So we want to set marginal revenue equal to zero. How do we find, if we have a demand curve like this, how do we find our marginal revenue? This is the tricky part, all right? I think it's on your formula sheet, though. So let me check to see if it is. If not, I'll put it on this board. Well,
on the side.
Yeah, I got. Oh yeah, it is. So, all right. So the formula is A. Minus 2B, it's on your sheet. So I'll put it over here, but we still need it. All right, so we want to find the marginal revenue for this. Oh, thanks. Actually, there you go. Whiteboard's the one I like the most. Yeah, no. Over there is left.
Okay, I'm gonna sit over here so I can read it.
Okay. Thanks. All right. So marginal revenue of this is A, 96, minus 2B, 8P. So here it is. I suppose on that screen, but on the Zoom, it's good. That screen is kind of slow.
What is it?
Peter, can you zoom in a little on the board? For Zoom, it's just somewhat blurry.
It's not my fault, so. Okay.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks.
Why is it P, not Q? Just look at when you see Q. That's just the variable that we're changing. All right, so it's P. I don't know. We're just going to do first. All right. So, anyways. So to maximize revenue, what are we going to set this equal to? Zero, right? So zero equals 96 minus 8P.
the X.
Like, let me make sure I'm doing this right.
I think you do need to manipulate it.
So yeah,
I think the inverse demand function.
Well,
so that
is right.
Correct.
Yeah. APX equals 96. All right, divide both sides by 8. So PX equals 12. So now we have price, but the question is asking for quantity output. So now we got to do quantity equals 96. And now is it minus 8 or minus 4? Because we were using just our original quantity demand function. 4 times our price, which is 12. So quantity equals 48. Now, I don't know what's going on with this one. I think there's two different ways you can solve it.
Maybe we could try setting like the original.
Yeah, okay, so let's set this. So this is our original one. And let's inverse this so that P is on the left side. All right, so we would get 4PX equals 96 minus Q. PX equals, what's 96 divided by 4? And then if we want to find marginal revenue, we do 24 minus 2 BQ. So it would be 0.25Q. All right, which gives us, that's our equation, set it equal to 0.
Wouldn't it be 1/2?
Multiply it by 2. Made it possible.
Thanks. Oh, geez, I just simplified it, huh? All right. Okay, so now 0 equals 0.5Q, and then we get, oh yeah, here we go. Q times both, divide both by negative 0.5, we get 48 equals Q.
So no matter which way you do it.
No, this was actually faster. Well, I guess you gotta do this thing. So it might be faster or slower. So I actually don't know why this one worked, but yeah, all right. Good question, remember I had that about, yeah, so it is. Water break. Anybody needs water?
Good question.
Yes, I'm not leaving. I'm coming back.
Just, in general, how similar would you consider this to the actual midterm?
So I did. I decided not to take the midterm last night because I knew if I did, I'd just give you guys all the answers. I think it's pretty similar, though.
Come on, Peter.
I know. I'm really sorry. I did that. Yeah, where's the mouse? Oh, you have the mouse. All right, let's do this. Hey, take a little break, all right? So go get some water. And on, speaking to you guys, just relax.
I worked on it last night mostly.
The other one you
said, like,
I have it.
I thought it was midday.
That's why. Otherwise, you know,
not gonna be sick. It's like,
yeah.
Actually, it's John.
open. I could do the vibe.
So we don't have class on Tuesday.
Yeah, he said it.
He was like,
you have to listen to this.
Birds, the brainwave
skateboard,
not the tram.
I like this thing that I was.
Rear development?
Yeah.
But like, is there like an assignment or something to do, right?
Every month sends out an email that you have to watch.
I don't have any, like,
I thought I remember talking about, like, said something like that.
It's just a pass, bro. I'm not taking it.
I hope everybody's break was good. I drink a whole thing of water and I'm pretty good.
Had a minute match later today. I got prepped for.
Halfway through the review, any questions? Anybody has not related to content? Because I'm live for this.
I don't know.
You getting the strategy jacket?
No, I haven't yet. Yeah, guys. This is very low key. Don't tell Danny I'm telling you guys to do this. But there's some extra strategy jackets. Like how you're going to decide who gets it. I think whoever spends the most time with the juniors should probably get one. And I also think that if you don't do that, just you should make the juniors vote because it's your jacket. So if you guys, you guys all vote for me.
Oh, Peter,
we have to do us. You're going to press that. How many answers would that be worth?
This test, I'll vote for you.
All right. Well, how about this? Somebody talk to Danny.
Get like jackets?
Well, we got a little gift. We got some polos, which are good workout polos, I guess. Well, we're having a bad match today. It's kind of sick to wear. I will go through the next Excel exercise better than I ever had before. All right. I'll do it nothing. I'll do like on Wednesday or Tuesday before, so I really know it.
Regardless, Peter,
you guys need to plant the idea in Danny's mind. You need to keep me like, it's like, hey, Danny, like, Another one gets the extra ones. I'll send it out. I don't record my reviews ever because we all know you think you're gonna learn the same. You watch it later, you're gonna watch it double speed, and it's good for reviewing, but not for like learning. Like going through stuff. This one probably could be recorded actually because it's like just going through problems, but still better in person. Like you actually learn in person. So I saw my Zoom call was still on. I've been recording this whole time too. Great. I said this before, this one actually is one of my favorite problems. This one was one of my favorites. I even made a video and sent it out. This is one we're going to do. All right. So if you watch that video, it goes straight through it. The machinery company tells you they have a new type of machine. I'll change your production function to Q equals K, 3, L. Price of capital is $450. Price of labor is $20. Each unit of output sells for $5. Price equals 5. Price, or you could say value, it's the same. The price just makes sense in my head. And it just makes sense. Labor is units. Asking how much capital should we use? So we have a couple of equations they give to us. And I don't know if they give you or unless you oh there it is. Let's see. So they do give it to you. So profit maximizing input usage to maximize your profit, because this company is looking to maximize profit, value of marginal capital equals the rental rate of capital, and the value of marginal labor equals the wage rate. All right, so we want to find how much capital we want to use to optimize profits. We want to equal this to each other. So we know the rental rate and we don't know capital. So if we solve this, you set this equation, which has an unknown, which is K, to this, then we'll be able to find what K is to maximize. All right, so let's do that. Value marginal, first thing we gotta find is the marginal product capital. Okay, so marginal product capital equals, this is also given to us on our formula sheet. It says, well, you guys have the formula sheet in front of you. I'll write it down. Well, it's online, so I'm not going to switch the camera. But capital.
Yeah, that's great.
That's fine. Yeah. Equals A minus 1. All right, you guys remember this equation? It's in that kind of mixed response, but. Capital equals A. So what's A in our situation here? It's K. So we don't know what that is yet. Then A minus 1, so 3 minus 1, which is 2. Then L, which is 10. And then to B, which is 1. Put that there. So we simplify this. The marginal product of capital equals 3K squared times 10. Means the marginal product of capital equals 30K squared. All right. Now the value marginal product of capital, we're almost to this point. Value marginal product of capital equals the 30K squared times the price, which they gave us is 5.
So our VMP is 150K squared. Now, we said that was equal to each other. We set the value of marginal product of capital, 150K squared, equal to the rental rate on capital. So we can maximize our profits, which is 450. Divide both by 150, K squared equals 3. Square both sides, or square root both sides, K equals square root of 3. All right, so this problem has like a lot of like little steps in it, but it's nice if you just work backwards. Think, I need to find this to maximize. In order to find this, I got to find my value marginal product of capital. To find that, I need to find my marginal product of capital, and I have an equation for that. Just kind of work through the steps. So.
It's in the, like under the marginal product part in the it says that for a Cobb Douglas production function, that's the marginal product of capital, like that's the formula it gives. So was this a situation of a Cobb Douglas function? Is that what
it
was?
Yes, because this is Cobb Douglas form. They're saying if you have a Cobb Douglas form, you can find the all these formulas using this. So I wonder if it even gives you. So on your little formula sheet, it tells you what A is, what B is. Because this right here is the Cobb Douglas. So it says that number is A, that number is B. So if you ever forget, you just look at your formula sheet. That's actually all right. Whiteboard space. Take a photo of this and make like a little Google Drive of all the photos or something like a Slack maybe. Crazy about the zoo.
I'm trying to sneak these for us. These are for us.
We will be eating these.
Every man walking.
Six guy. On to number 30. So, very looking at producer surplus. The supply function is given by Q supply equals 0.25 EX minus 10. At a price of $80, how much producer surplus will there be in the market? Okay, so first off, here's our graph. This is demand. This is supply. Price is $80. So, as the last one, except we're just looking for a producer surplus instead of consumer surplus. So let's first solve for our $80. Quantity supplied, at $80. So quantity supplied equals 580 minus 10. Supplied equals 10.20. So now our next thing we want to find is where our supply function crosses the y-axis. So if price was zero, how much would if quantity was zero, at what price would they start supplying? Yeah. We find that?
Zero for Q.
Yeah. Okay, nice. So then we get, this is our little triangle here. So this height is 40. This length, 10. 10 times 40 times 0.5. So we get 200. So again, I drew both lines so we can see the man line and the supply line. But when I solve this problem, I just draw one line. I just draw whatever line I'm dealing with. So I'm just dealing with supply. It's all here. Okay. But you should know that producer surplus is on the bottom, consumer surplus is on the top. Okay. This is good. You are negotiating with all your best customers. You want to, the cost of running contract with customer is marginal cost of length of contract equals 50 plus 3L. And the benefit is marginal benefit of the contract. The length of contract is 500. L is contract length in weeks. How many weeks should you cover? So this is just a straight conceptual problem. You want the benefit to be exactly equal to the cost. So you say 500 equals 50 plus 3L, 450 equals 3L, 150 equals L. Why you want the benefit to be equal to the cost is if your benefit's more than the cost, you should spend or buy or do whatever a little bit more until you can get no more benefit out of that situation. Or out of hiring a new person or out of being a longer contract or whatever. So, and then if your benefit's less than the cost, then you should reduce your costs by doing a lower amount of contract length or having one less person or whatever until they're exactly the same. So you're not optimized until they're equal to each other. Can you talk about specialized investments and holdups and stuff in class? Okay. I think I just missed that day. So I was like, I don't remember that. Book,
mention it for like 1 second.
Slide on it.
All right, so let's just kind of list out what they are. I want to pull up the slides and make sure we don't miss any. So we have hold up. Once, is it just hold up?
Opportunism.
Opportunism.
ISM.
Okay, this is right. I don't know how to spell the ISM part. Anyways, right? Was there any other one? Does anybody have the slides up? Let's pull that up. So hold up is when somebody makes a very, very specialized investment and in something and they can't use it without the other firm letting them use it. So yeah, probably. These other slides on mine too, aren't you?
Vertical integration.
Okay, nice.
Investment.
I'm going to say what they are. Yeah. Spot exchange is when you have very specialized oil pipeline. You guys talk about this in 401? Not yet? Okay. So if you have like an oil pipeline or something, and the pipeline takes it from the refinery to the consumer. Whoever owns that pipeline has complete holdup because without that pipeline, the refinery can't take it to the consumers. And so they need that pipeline. So they can charge as much as they want, pretty much. And that's why you write contracts to say, hey, don't charge us that much. Strat can help reduce that. And vertical integration would be if the refinery bought the pipeline, So that way they have control over both and they're not going to hold up themselves. All right. Yeah, pretty much all you, I mean, that was pretty common sense. Like you all just see and be like, oh, okay, that makes sense.
Which slide deck was that on?
It's on power suppliers. Slide,
in order for like new change.
It's slide 21.
Yeah.
Charging more, you already have some content.
Great. So I said we're going to go over that. We didn't really, but it's fine. Okay, so yeah, this is the example they give us. As part of the agreement, Acme builds a very costly mold that can only be used to produce parts for the covers made by the partnership. The mold has no value outside the partnership. That's a huge, like, clue on that. Acme supplies parts to Advance. Advance assembles the parts and sells the finished product. Acme and Advance agree to share all revenues equally. After the first month of production, Advance informed Acme that Advance would retain 70% of revenues and give Acme only 30% of revenues. The situation is Acme has made a specialized investment and Advance is engaged in opportunism. Hold up, specifically hold up. Because Acme specializes in mold, there's nothing else they can do with the mold at all. And Acme's taking advantage of that by giving them less money than they originally agreed on. All right.
What letter was that?
That was question 32.
What letter was the answer?
A. Yeah. All right. 33, oligopoly differs from monopoly as follows. Oligopoly involves a few firms, monopoly is one. Yeah. And about advertising providers, and there's no free entry in oligopoly because there's barriers to entry. That's why it's an oligopoly. 34, an electronics company acquires one of its main suppliers. So if a company acquired a supplier, that is vertical integration. Exactly. It's taking global supply chain. This is kind of a flex. I did that class all in one afternoon. That was due. I forgot about it. Midterm, the final, and the project. Yeah. Entire class. I got an A, 98 or something. It actually was very stressful, though. It was my most, one of my top 10 most class performances in my
top seven.
I got a few. Not a band. I had done the first module, first week, and I thought I had done more, and it turns out I just did it. That was my semester during 412 and 411. So,
that's right now. You want to take my final?
Yeah. No, but yeah, I think it's stressful because you have to get a 95, get an A. And so like I remember at 2 p.m. I hadn't started yet. And I called my buddy Isaac, like, it's going to determine if I get an A or A minus. If I get D in this class, like, it's all so unknown. What's going to happen? I call him like 11:57. And I was like, let's go. All right. They're the manager of a firm that sells this product in a competitive market. So we know it's not a monopoly. At a price of $50. The cost function is cost equals 40 plus 5Q squared. So the profit maximizing output for your firm is, well, let's set marginal revenue equal to marginal cost. So we're gonna do 50 equals, what's our marginal cost? Exactly. Thank you. 5 equals Q. Function this time. Okay, you're the manager of a firm that sells this product in a competitive market at a price of $40. Price equals 40. This is 36.
Hey, Peter, can we slide the camera back over?
Sorry.
You're all good.
Our camera guy. Oh, that's you. Give me this back. I can't trust myself. Yeah, you can see us now.
Yeah, if you could zoom in just a little bit, it might help. But yeah, we can see the board.
Yeah, well, carry on. So this one is your firm's cost function is this is cost equals 60 plus 4K squared. The firm's maximum profits are, well, first let's look at our profit maximizing output. So
you guys can't see the board.
So we're gonna do marginal revenue equals marginal cost. All right. Quantity produced is going to be 5, right? So our profit is going to be our total revenue minus our total cost, which you guys all know. So our profit is going to be our quantity, which is 5 times our price, which is 40, minus our cost curve, which is 60 plus 4 times 5 squared. All right, and this is our profit is going to be times that lot. This is 200. This is 160. Yeah, sweet. You're a manager of monopoly that faces the demand curve described by P equals 230 minus 20Q. Your costs are C equals 5 plus 30Q. Your firm's maximum profits are? So this is a monopoly, our demand curve, 30 minus 20Q, and our costs are 5 plus 30Q. Okay, so how do we, as a monopoly, how do we maximize profit per equation? I don't have the answer to this one written down. I couldn't do it last night.
R equals MC.
Yeah. All right. So our MR equals 230 minus 40Q. All right. Our price, our revenue is this. And our marginal cost equals 30. All right. So let's do 230 minus 40Q equals 30. Should we produce? So we have, oh, this is how we do it. All right.
Where's 40Q coming from?
40Q is coming from the 20Q, but it's times 2 because we're looking for the marginal revenue of the monopoly. All right, so we get this equals negative 40Q equals 200. 200 divided both by negative 40 equals 5. All right, and we want profits. So we are going to do quantity of 5. Do we know what price we're pricing at yet? No, we don't. All right, so price equals 230 minus 20 times 5. It's the quantity we're producing. So price equals 130, which means our max profits equal 130 times 5 minus our cost, which is 5 plus 30 times 5. So we get 550. So 650 minus 150 plus 5, 155. Yes, it's looking pretty good, everybody. And we get 495. Yes. Yes. All right. Look at that. No notes.
Thank you.
That's great to know. What contributes to the existence of multi-product firms? All right. So let's look. Which ones have to do with firm? Which one would be beneficial if a firm had two products? Economies of scale? No, because you have one product to make a bunch of them. That's economies of scale. Economies of scope?
Yes.
Cost complementarity? Same thing, pretty much. All right. So D, B, and C. All right. No duopoly would enjoy higher profits if you're looking at a or no duopoly. I don't know which number this is. You have your firms you've seen right here. If they both reduced their output, price would go up. So they would enjoy profits if output was reduced. This is A. But why don't firms do that? Why don't they both reduce output? The market demand in a Bertrand duopoly. So what's this one? You actually don't really need to look at the columns, but Bertrand duopoly. Know about those? Well, we know that price equals marginal cost. So the first one's right. We know that if they're the same, if they have the same fixed costs, then the profits are going to be the exact same. And if they have the same profits and fixed costs, they're going to produce the same amount. So the producer surplus of firm one is going to equal the producer surplus of firm two. They're all just the same. So it's going to be D, all of them. Okay, 41 is a little tricky. You need to kind of get a little tripped up on until you know it, and then you won't ever make a mistake. Forty-one. Market demand in a Bertrand duopoly is P equals 100 minus 2Q. The marginal cost of firm one is $10. So I'm going to say MC1 equals 10. And the marginal cost of firm two is 13. What price would you expect to see in this market? And how many units would each firm sell at this price? All right, so if your marginal cost is less, that means that you're gonna be the one to design the price. So if you're firm one, what are you gonna price your product at? Marginal cost? Let's go a little bit higher. Would you price at 13? No, because then they can still be in the market. You price at 12, it's right below them. So that way these guys can't compete at all, but you can still get the max profit you can get from your product. The reason why you wouldn't price at 10 is because at 10, these guys can't compete, which is good, but you could price it for $2 more, get all that profit, and they still can't compete. So to answer, how many units would each firm sell at this price? Well, price is 12 equals 100 minus 2Q. And we know that just only firm one will sell anything. Firm two won't be able to sell because it's too price is too low for them. So it's going to be 2Q equals 88. U equals 40. And firm two, I'm going to be able to sell any units. All right.
Peter, and for that, are we just assuming that we're only operating in whole numbers, that it would be 12 instead of 1250?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah, I always operate in whole numbers. I think for the midterm. If you don't, you'll like be explicit about it.
Okay, thanks.
Is this board two?
Want this board? It's not about her.
You can keep.
Just up here, almost done. And yeah. Two. Okay, two identical firms compete as a Cournot duopoly. demand they face is P equals 100 minus 2Q. Is for each firm, its cost equals 4Q. And the equilibrium output of each firm is, we don't know. Let's figure that out. All right. So what formula are we going to use on our formula sheet? Cornell. We're going to use the Cornell formula here, which you guys have in front of you, so I'm not going to write out. But it is quantity of 1 equals A, which is 100. Okay. Minus cost of 1, which is 4. 2 times B, which is negative 2. Minus 1/2 Q. I think it's just 2 because our function is, I don't know.
Oh, and then the coefficient.
Why is it 2 negative 2?
It's a minus, right?
Is that it?
He said, like, don't worry with the negative. It's just always positive. Whatever reason. I don't know why he said that.
It makes sense because you're looking at output.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense.
Have a negative slope, isn't it?
Yeah, so it just, it doesn't matter.
You choose the coefficient. Yeah, 2.
Yeah, so just, who cares? Just always, always positive, all right? That's what we're going to do. We're doing it, and, Yeah, no, he did literally say that. He was like, I don't.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, all right. Okay. So let's simplify this. Q1 equals, this comes out to 24. This comes out to 0.5, but it's the same. Q2. All right. Now we know Q2, they have the same exact function. And so it's going to be exactly the same. End of Q2 is going to be 24 minus 0.5 Q1. Everything's the same. I think on your test, you might get one with different things, or you might get one with the same. It's the only options you have. But just make sure you know which switch, all right? All right, sweet. If you not know which right now, but when you're taking the test, don't confuse quantity of firm 1 and quantity of firm 2 because they're different. Okay. So if you want to find the... quantity of 1, formula is quantity of 1 equals 24 minus 0.5. Plug in Q2 right there, 24 minus 0.5 Q1. We're going to simplify all that to make equals 12 somehow. Yeah, 24 take away 12. And plus that, so 12 plus 0.25 Q1, 0.75 Q1, so taking that 0.25 from here, equals 12, 21 equals 16, yeah, 16. All right, and because both the firms are the same, the output is 16. That's the answer, B. Okay. Firm 1 and firm 2 compete as a Cournot oligopoly. There's an increase in marginal cost for firm 1. Okay. So if a firm's marginal cost increases, what's going to happen? It's going to produce less because the marginal cost is higher. Because that one's producing less, the other firm that's competing with it, it's going to react with it, it's going to produce more. And profits of the firm 1 that's producing less is going to decrease. So the one that's not true in this answer is that both of the reaction functions are shifted. Firm 1's reaction function is shifted because its costs were affected, its marginal costs were affected. But firm 2, they just react to whatever firm 1 puts out. So nothing that firm 1 changes will shift firm 2's reaction function. They'll move along their function, but they won't shift to the side and have a new function. All right. 44. So a differentiated Bertrand oligopolis, firm 1, competes in a market with another firm, firm 2. Their demand functions are Q1 equals 30 minus 3P1 plus Q2. And Q2 equal 30, same demand function again. Or just flips. All right. Costs are zero. Good. So what are the equilibrium prices? Start off with anyways, I'll send you guys a recording. I'll put it on the Slack or something for the last problems.
Peter.
Sorry, this kind of seemed a little longer than that. I guess it's a pretty long practice test. So, as quick as I can. Why he found total revenue on this, but. Yeah, how do we find the Bertrand-Nash equilibrium prices? What's there even like our process if it's like find the equilibrium price for Bertrand?
It's in the formula.
Yeah, it's
steps 1 through 10.
Oh, he gives that to you guys on the test?
Wow.
All right. This okay. Okay. Yeah, so I can just write this out.
Mile.
Okay. Yeah, total revenue equals P1 times Q1. All right, here's just the whole thing here. Let me just grab this. Oops. Nope. Okay, so first we find total revenue. So this is 30P1 minus 3P1 squared plus P2. That's fine. Marginal revenue, which is going to be the derivative of the total revenue function, 30 and 6P plus P2. Okay, now it says equal to zero. Zero equals 30 minus 6P1 plus P2. And then simplify this. So it's 6P equals 30 plus P2. P1 equals 5 plus 1, 6. P2. Okay, so this is the reaction function for firm one. It'll be the same for firm two, which you don't have to do because they're the same formula, which is great. Now we substitute the reaction functions here. Substitute P2 for the reaction function of P2. So we get P1 equals 5 plus 1/6 P2, which is 30 minus 3 P. Five plus 1/6, there we go. All right, so P1 equals 5 plus 5/6 plus 1/36 P1. P1 equals 35/36 P1. We're going to subtract this from this side. Equals 35 over 36. This is just 5 plus 5, 6, 30. 35 over 36. I mean, 35 over 6. So 35 over 6 times 36 over 35. That's the first time I've done that since I took the final last year. Happy it turns out, and that's the answer. Nice. We're at the last problem. We're going to do it in a minute, then we'll be out of here. And I have hours till 1:50, so say if you want. But take a photo of this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Deuces.
Yeah. One. I longer midterm than I thought. Practice exam. Holy cow. Yo, clip it. This one is definitely on the test, and I have like 5 questions on it. So I'm doing this on the practice test. Yeah, so. Hey, clip it's costs. Cost to clip it equals 2 quantity. Clip it. Fasten it. Cost of fasten it equals 4 quantity of fasten it. And profit or inverse demand function is P equals 500 takeaway 2Q. All right. Wait. So what quantity should Clipit put on the market? So we know that Clipit has a cost advantage. So that means they're the leader of this. All right. And there's a firm with the leader. And we want to use our formula for Thackelbird. All right. So formula for this leader output is Q leader equals A plus C 2 minus 2 C1 over 2B. And quantity of follower equals A minus C2 consistent. C2 is follower, C1 is leader. C follower over 2B. So, first, asking us for Clipit first. Okay, so Clipit's the leader. So, we're going to say quantity of the leader equals A, which is 500, plus the cost of the follower, which is fasten it. So, plus 4. Thank you there. Minus 2 times the cost of Clipit, which is 2, all over 2B, which is 2, and then negative 2. Wait, so does this be positive?
Yes.
500 plus 4 minus 4, so 500 over 4. So the quantity of the leader, which is Clipit, is going to equal 125. It's around here, but that's right. Can I get my phone back? Right here. Okay, so next question asks, what quantity should fasten it put on the market in response to the Clipit? All right, so fasten it is going to have to use their reaction function. So their response is 500A minus cost of fasten it, which is 4 over 2 B, which is 2. Okay, minus 1/2 quantity of the leader, which is 125. So quantity fasten it equals 496 divided by 4 minus 67. Excellent. 62.5. Want to just do this?
61.5 is the final.
All right, so they're going to be 61.5. And I think, yeah, he doesn't round this one for whatever reason, even though you probably think it. So the answer is D. Okay. Yeah. What will be the equilibrium price on this market? So the market is producing an equilibrium when they're both producing in reaction to each other. So this is equilibrium production. So our price is going to be 500 minus 2, 125 plus 61.5. So our price is going to be 500 takeaway 373. Price equals 27. What profits do they earn respectively? So the profits of Clipit are going to be quantity produced, which is 125, times the price, which is 127, minus their cost curve, which is 2 times the quantity produced, which is 125. So the profits of Clipit are 15,625. All right. Now the profits of Fascinate. Oh, what side of this? Oh, this is right. Profits of Fascinate are quantity produced, which is 61.5 times the price, which is 127. That's 2 or -4 times the quantity they produce, which is 61.5. That gives us the profit of Fascinate is 7,500. All right. Estimate. What happened? Monopoly. Monopoly. And price a monopolistic output. So the price formula is still 500 takeaway 2Q. But the marginal revenue we find 500 takeaway 4Q. And we're going to set that equal to our marginal cost as monopoly. So our marginal cost we know is 2, because that's what our derivative of this is, our cost curve. So we're going to take with 4q equals 2. And this is 4q equals 498. So q equals 124.5. So this is the quantity producing, but we don't use the same price we already have because now the market's a little bit different. We're going to find our new price. Let's go up here. Our new price is 500 takeaway 2, 124. Price is 251. All right, now to end this up. Profits of the new firm, say profits of new, equal quantity produced times the price. See how the price would be way higher because it came in monopoly. The cost, which is 2 times our quantity, 124.5. So our new profits equal.
Accounting or anything? Doing that? So here's Lee Hill.